Thank you. Awesome. Thank you, Tom. Well, that was totally just amazing, Tom. Thank you very much. And it's my privilege to extend a warm welcome to all of you in the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Jeff Carlson, and it is a really honor and great privilege to officiate at Bill's homegoing service. I'm his pastor, obviously, and very glad to say a friend, his friend. And so thank you for, on behalf of the family, coming out and being a part of the service today. I know there's a lot of difficulties that we're all facing through some of the pandemic, but thank you for coming out and joining us today. One of the privileges about knowing Bill is that from the moment I met him many years ago until the last time I saw Bill is that his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ never wavered in any way. And so Bill finished his journey in a wonderful way with faith on his lips. And we're here today to celebrate a couple of things. The first thing we're here to do, and most importantly, is to celebrate really Bill's faith and hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our first thing that we're here to do. The second thing that we're here to do is to celebrate Bill's life and the legacy, I believe, that he's given to all of us, to his family and to his church. And so those are a couple of our purposes here today. You know, one of the things about being a pastor is that you get to talk about heaven once in a while, and hopefully we should be talking more about it, I think, than we do. But you know one of the great things about heaven? The great thing about heaven is nothing is going to change there. You know, right now, everything is changing. Are you feeling it out there? Everybody feeling that out there today? That everybody doesn't know what's going to happen next week, tomorrow? Nobody knows what is going to happen, and we're all a little anxious, aren't we? And that's because deep down inside, we're not designed by the Lord to be living with this kind of change. And this change is part of living in a fallen world. And one of the wonderful things about Bill is that his faith and the things that he knew were important never changed. And yet it seems to me so much of our culture, I mean, even in the church today, it seems like things are changing every week. And so I think it's even in our churches sometimes we're not really sure what's unchangeable, what's eternal, what is never going to end, what things are important for each of us to have in our own lives that we can build a foundation on for the future. As a pastor now for about 37 years, one of the things that I absolutely rejoiced in is having an opportunity to put together a service like that. I don't know if you'll see in this service, there is an unchangeable sense of the Lord Jesus Christ in this service that is just spectacular. And I feel just privileged to be a part of working with the family to put this together. Bill came in here with the family on the song, The Holy City, which is about the new Jerusalem. And it's what's coming. Wonderful future one day. And I think as you go through and take a look at all of the elements here, this is a classic service for a classic Christian. It is a service of things that will never change about our Lord. And I think it also is going to end with really a witness to one of the things that Bill felt was important was his military service. And so after the service, we're going to go out as a group on Amazing Grace. We're going to go outside, and it appears the Lord is going to hold the weather, and we're going to have a military honor guard to celebrate Bill's military service as the conclusion to the service. And then we hope that you will stay and join us for a really wonderful lunch. We'd hope to have everything outside, but Michigan weather kind of changed the story a little bit, so we're going to be inside here today. And also, too, if you have any offerings or anything you'd like to give in Bill's memory, the family has requested that Oak Hill Church, his church family and home, would receive those gifts. Wow. Isn't it wonderful? Heaven will never change. Isn't that great? Looking forward to that. Let's have a word of prayer together here today. Well, our Father, we thank you that where we hope to go one day to be with you, Lord, is where our dear and precious brother Bill is at this time. Lord, we thank you that all through his life, Bill had an unchanging, unwavering faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. Father, we thank you for that faith that Bill carried throughout his life, that shaped his life, that was part of his marriage, building his family and all of the things that he did, Lord. It was all based on that foundation in his life. And so, Lord, today, as we gather to sing your praises, to thank you for sending us such a wonderful Savior, so kind and gracious and wonderful for each of us, Lord, we pray that we would honor you, Lord, in Bill's homegoing. We also pray, Lord, that we would celebrate his life. And I think to learn maybe some important things about the lasting legacy that Bill has left to all of us here today. So, Father, we pray that you will bless our service with your presence. We pray, Lord, that this service will be truly a wonderful expression of all that you are for Bill and for us here this morning. And we give the service to you, and we pray all these things in the Lord Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to sing here this morning, and I'm going to make a little intro on this first song, My Savior First of All. You know, I was talking with the family. Bill was what I refer to as a classic Christian. How many of us have ever heard of Fanny Crosby? Anybody ever heard of Fanny Crosby? Now, if we were the group under 40, no hands would be up. But a lot of people remember Fanny Crosby. Maybe you remember Fanny Crosby was born blind. And she wrote hundreds of hymns about the Lord and had never had the ability to see anything. And she wrote this song, My Savior First of All, because she knew that when the Lord called her home, the first thing that she would ever have seen in her life was the face of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's powerful. And so this song this morning is a tribute to that beautiful future vision that we have of our Lord, and it's called My Savior First of All, and we're going to put the words up here, and I'd like to ask that you would all stand. We're all going to sing that together here as Bill's family and friends as we celebrate his homegoing and our future with our Lord. Tom? Man, you may be seated. One of the most important things for any of us here today is to hopefully leave this service with maybe a little more faith in the Lord than when we came in here. I think all of the chances to meet with the Lord's people, and especially I think during a funeral and homegoing, is the Lord wants to speak to us and to grow us and to build our faith. I just got an email from one of my seminary friends here the other night, and he's trying to help a young man who doesn't seem to have any faith. Just sent this back to him last night. As a matter of fact, it's kind of interesting. And I think the great purpose of the church, the great purpose of our work here, is to help everyone, whatever our age, to have a hope and a simple and beautiful faith in the Lord. It's a beautiful, simple thing. And that's why we're all here. That's why we're all here, to celebrate Bill's hope, our hope, but also to maybe help anyone find hope if we don't have any. So that's my prayer, if anyone here today, or all of us, need to have some hope today. And after preaching and teaching now for about 40 years, I can tell you that we all wrestle at moments with unbelief. We all have uncertainty at times about things. And that's why the Bible was written, so that we would have a hope and that the Lord would make it clear. If you were to ask me, what would you share with somebody that didn't have any sense of hope about that God is real, that the Bible is true? What would you do with somebody? And I would say very simply, what I would do is take them into the Old Testament, as we're going to do now, and I would read to them Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53 was written 2,700 years ago, but 700 years before Christ was born. 700 years, that's almost three times the length this country's been around. And as we hear these words about our Lord and about His love for us, I think every one of us will hear in this passage the story of the babe born in Bethlehem, our wonderful Savior that Bill trusted and that we can too. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before Him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to Him. There was nothing in His appearance that we should desire Him. He was despised and He was rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised and we esteemed Him not. But surely He took up our infirmities. He carried our sorrows, and yet we considered Him stricken by God, smitten by Him and afflicted. But He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was on Him. You see, all of us are like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to their own way, and the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet He did not open His mouth. He was like a lamb led to the slaughter, as a sheep before her shearers is silent. So He did not even open His mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can speak of His descendants, because He was cut off from the land of the living for the transgression of my people. He was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in His death, though He had done nothing wrong. There was no violence in His mouth or any deceit, and yet it was God's will to crush Him. God's will to cause Him to suffer, and His life would become an offering for us. And He will see His offspring and prolong His days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in His hand. And after the suffering of His soul, He will see the light of life. We call that Easter, the resurrection. After the suffering of His soul, He will see the light of life and be satisfied. And by His knowledge, my righteous servant will justify and forgive many, because He will bear their sins. Therefore, I will give Him a portion among the great, and He will divide the spoils with the strong, because He poured out His life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors, for He bore the sin of many and made intercession for their sins. That was written 2,700 years ago, a beautiful story of Christmas, the babe born in the manger. What a wonderful story about our Lord. I think this passage just builds faith, I think, maybe like nothing else. It's a very, very beautiful passage. Let's take a look at one other passage here in the Old Testament, and I'm going to pull one here from the book of Job. You know, the central question that every pastor is asked, and I've been asked this 1,000 times, it always comes down to something about suffering. You've ever noticed that? When we go through a really tough valley, we go through suffering. And I think a little bit at the end, Bill went through a little bit of some suffering, and he suffered a little bit with beautiful Diane and their family. There were some challenges that came in here in the last year or two with Bill's health, and that's hard. And you know, I can tell you this, we'll never fully understand all of our sufferings. I don't think we'll ever fully understand all the things that may happen to us or we sometimes happen to others. Many people come to me and ask me to sort it out. But a lot of times, no pastor can really do that. What I can say is that we live in a fallen world. We're separated from our Lord. And so, yeah, we're going to have some trials down here. But why was the book of Job written? It's not written about Job. I know that sounds strange. The book of Job is not written about Job. Job never knew why he fully suffered. The only person in the history of the world that ever knew why he suffered was the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord knew why he suffered. We just read about it. He suffered for us. He suffered to take away our suffering. That's the lost story, I think, sometimes of the book of Job. And so in Job chapter 19, I think this is Bill's confession. This is my confession. I hope that it is your confession. Because it has Job crying out that he's going through all these trials, he's going through difficulties, all kinds of stuff. Many of you know what happened to Job. But notice what he said. He's crying out to the Lord. He says, oh, Job says in Job 19, he says, oh, that my words were recorded. He wanted somebody to know what he's going through. And I can tell you, suffering is not something easily communicated to people. Sometimes the suffering that we go through are beyond what we would call words. But we want someone to know, but the Lord knows, doesn't he? Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead or engraved in rock forever. He wants somebody to know about what he's going through. And then he goes into the greatest Old Testament confession about hope. This is amazing. Verse 25, he says, and I know, in the midst of this, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, he will stand upon the earth. Wow. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my own body, in my own flesh, I will see God. I will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. Oh, how my heart yearns within me. Bill Kooistra had that confession, no doubt about that. And I think that to me is a very hopeful sense of the Old Testament. Between Isaiah and Job, there's the whole story. We're looking for someone to understand our suffering, to suffer for us, and to overcome it all as our Lord did with his resurrection. Amen. Well, at this time, we're going to have some family come up here, and I just kind of thought about this, you know, Carrie Kooistra. I wonder what they called her, K-squared, you know, Carrie Kooistra. But anyway, Bill's daughter, Carrie, is going to come up with her handsome husband, Mark, and they're going to start off and do a little bit of some reflections from the family. So, Carrie, dear, here's the mic, and we'll get our mic up for them. Okay, there we go.
Jeff said, keep it close to your face. So, am I good?
You're good.
All right. When my mom asked me last week, will you get up and say something about Dad? My answer was, absolutely not. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm actually in sales. I get up in front of people 3 times a week and talk, and I've given presentations to hundreds of people. This, by far, is the hardest thing I have ever had to do. But that night, it was Friday night, I got to bed, and as I lay there till 3 in the morning, yeah, he was snoring, I kept thinking, what would I want people to know about my dad? And I had a very, I guess I'll call it a humble epiphany. I thought, who at the funeral will have known my dad for 50 years or more? And there's a very small smattering of people here today that have known my dad that long, and I'm one of them. So, my mom has known my dad for 56 years. I've known my dad for 51 years, so in the grand scheme of things, I've known my dad almost as long as my mom has. So I thought, who better to get up and talk about dad? So there are so many things I could say about him. As Bill Kooistra, the man, I would say he was a very bright man. First word that comes to my mind, he was very intelligent. And I always thought growing up, my dad's the smartest man I know. And I've even said in recent years, I've said, I think my dad is one of the smartest men I've ever known. I think the nursing home would agree with that, because he was a stinker up until the end. I mean, for those of you who don't know, we had him in a nursing home for 5 days, and he got kicked out because he was so smart. He knew how to escape. He escaped 6 times in 5 days. And the second home he was at, they really loved him, and they got to know my dad well. And they even said, he's a bright man. He's a very smart man. And I've said over the months to many of you, I have said, why didn't the Alzheimer's take the intelligent side of my dad first? It took the emotional side, and that's been very difficult for all of us. But he was bright. And my mom shared with us recently, it's been fun to reminisce these last few weeks. She shared that some of my dad's teachers, one of the dean of students at one of his colleges, had said to my dad, you are probably one of the brightest men that have ever been through these halls. And I said, I knew it. I knew my dad was smart. And he was just very bright. My dad was very loyal. My dad was loyal to his wife, to his family, to his friends. Look at all the people that are here. He was loyal to each and every one of us. He was loyal to his church. But he was also loyal to the country that he served. As you guys know, he was in the U.S. Air Force. He served during the Korean War, and ironically enough, he was in the intelligence division of the Air Force. And what my dad did was he was a decoder. Now, how cool is that? My dad decoded enemy intel, and I think that is so awesome. But he never talked about it, and I never really thought much about it until my mother just shared the story with us. He never said anything to us about what he did. And think now, today, my kids would think that is so cool that Grandpa was a decoder in during a war. But my mom told us he was so loyal, he was loyal to a fault. Even up until recent years, she would say, Bill, you can share a story with me. You can tell me something that you unearthed back during the Korean War. He wouldn't do it. He took an oath. He was loyal to a fault. So I can say today the U.S. government can rest assured that Bill Kooistra literally went to the grave with the secrets that he unearthed during the Korean War, because he never, ever shared those secrets. My goodness, the words I've heard just over the last 24 hours. My dad was classy. He never had a hair out of place. He was always pressed. But I think what our family would want you to know, and this is a word that has come up again and again and again, my dad was a good man. You've used it many times. My dad was a good man. He was honest. He was loyal. He was hardworking. He was faithful. My dad was the epitome of good. He really was. Growing up, I'm sure all of you have heard the story, my mom has told you, Brett and I never fought. We were weird kids, it's true. We never fought. We never fought. And I can only speak for myself, but I know growing up that I never wanted to disappoint my parents. And that's what kept me from being naughty, I think, up until even my adult years. Even now, I kind of use my dad as kind of my moral compass. Watching a TV show, watching a movie. Would Dad watch that? I don't think Dad would watch that. Seriously, he's been my moral compass. I will share a story. Please do not judge me. There was a movie that I watched a few years back with a girlfriend, and I still shake my head, because sitting in that theater, I kept thinking, if my parents knew I was in this movie. And I know I confessed it to my mother, but I never told my dad. Because there was just a goodness about, and you're good, don't get me wrong. But she was a stinker, let's be honest. But my dad was a good man. But as everybody in this room knows, my dad is not seated at the feet of Jesus today because he was a good man. Goodness did not get him there. My dad was a godly man, first and foremost. My dad knew God, and he loved the Lord Jesus up until the end. My mom and dad did everything in their power to raise Brett and I so that we would have those seeds to make that decision for ourselves. We prayed at mealtime. We prayed at bedtime. They sent us to the Christian schools. We went to church. We went to catechism. They did everything right. And I have that as an early memory of my father, but one of the most vivid memories I have about my dad, when I was in high school, I had to write a religious paper, and I still remember the topic, and it was on Matthew 7, not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, will be saved. Now talk about a topic for a 16-year-old, oh my goodness. And I remember vividly sitting at the kitchen table at Burning Tree with my dad, with the Bible out and the concordance out. He had his notebook for taking notes, I had my notebook, and my dad sat up late into the night with me writing that paper. He did not write it, folks. I wrote the paper, but he gave me the seeds and he gave me the knowledge. And I remember asking him at the end of that, I said, how do you know so much about the Bible? I was just kind of blown away by that knowledge that he had. But it's not just knowledge. My dad had that deep faith in that relationship with Jesus. My kids are going to roll their eyes because I'm going to quote my favorite song group. Who's my favorite song group that I play all the time? Casting Crowns. About a year ago, they came out with a song entitled Only Jesus. And when that song came out, it hit me. I played it over and over and over again. I even brought it down to Nathan because my kids roll their eyes when I listen to this group. I even brought it down to Nate, and I said, listen to the song, and I just played that song to him. And while I was laying in bed last Friday night thinking about my dad, the song came to me. And the lyrics of the song say, I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. That depicts my dad. My dad does not want us to remember him for his BA, his AB as he had it written down, or his MBA. He doesn't want to be remembered for how he dressed or for the awesome cars that he had. Oh, they're down now, but the cars that he had. That's not what my dad wanted to be remembered for. What mattered to my dad more than anything were that his kids and his grandkids knew and loved Jesus Christ. I'm going to put you on the spot. Not a lot. I'm looking at you. Not a lot of you know this, but last Wednesday night, Jody, my sister-in-law, spent the night with my dad at Provision Living. I am eternally grateful because that is not something I could have done. But Jody stepped up, and she spent the entire night with my dad, holding his hand, and I'm going to embarrass you. She talked with him, she played music with him, and she told us she sang to him. Why she admitted this, I'll never know, but she did say that while she was singing, Dad crinkled his face up. So it's either the song choices or it was the quality of the singing. We're not sure. When Pastor Jeff asked us, does anybody in the family want to do special music, we all kind of looked at Jody, probably not Jody. But Jody did share with me that while she was talking to Dad, and as she held his hand, she says, Dad, your kids know Jesus and they love Jesus. And she says, Dad, your grandkids love Jesus and they know Jesus. She says, you can go home, Dad. And I'd say it was within 12 hours. You went home. That mattered to him more than anything, that legacy, that his kids and his grandkids knew Jesus Christ. All of them, all five of these grandkids, have at one point in time written their statements of faith. My three kids from this pulpit, not that many years ago, they did their profession of faith. And my kids had typed it out so they could read it. I'm like their mother, sitting here shaking like a leaf. When they were done, my dad said to me, I want copies of their statement of faith. I'm like, okay, Dad. He goes, no, I want copies of those. A couple days later, I made photocopies for him, and he had those. And I know that he referred back to all five of them often. Last week, as we were going through pictures in the photo album, we came across the pictures of my kids making profession of faith. And inserted in the photo album, next to each child, was typed from Dad's typewriter, their statement of faith. And Rachel said, Grandma, Grandpa kept these? And she said, oh, honey, Grandpa looked at those all the time. And that's what mattered to him. Is that legacy, and that's the legacy that he left, is that faith in Jesus Christ. There's one more thing I want to share. It's going to get tough, and this is for my mom. My dad loved us. There's nobody in these first two rows that'll ever doubt that Grandpa loved us. We were greeted with a hug or a kiss. When we left their house, we were greeted with a hug or a kiss. When I heard my kids on the phone with Grandpa, it was always, I love you too, Grandpa. Same with my dad. Oftentimes I travel the state, and oftentimes on my way home, I'll call my mom and we can chat for over an hour on the phone as she gets me home from Lansing or Novi or wherever I am. But my dad would get on the phone often, and he never, ever, ever did he say just goodbye. It was always, I love you. He loved us. But as you all know, in this room, my dad was very reserved. He wasn't what I would call a touchy-feely guy. He wasn't a very affectionate guy. And I know there was affection with my mom and dad, but that wasn't the side that my brother and I saw often, probably for obvious reasons. But I know it was there. And in the stories that my mom has shared with us over the last couple of weeks, she said to us, she said, your dad and I had so much fun when we first started dating. She said, we laughed. And he, as you all know, there's a big age difference. And so he was quite established when he started dating this young chick. And he would take her out of the city to go to musicals and to go to plays. And he bought nice places to eat and all of that. And she said, we had so much fun. And I said, Brett, we did something. We ruined it for him. But they had fun. And I'm going to embarrass you. You got me up here on the stool, so I am going to embarrass you. As we were going through pictures last week, we were looking at all my dad's cars. And one car in particular, she goes, oh, that was a fun car. I'll keep it PG. And she says, we used to make out in that car. And Rachel says, Grandma! And she goes, what, we just play kissy face? And Rachel says, Grandma! I think Drew was there too. The poor kid was turning purple. But there was fun and there was affection, and my dad loved, and he loved dearly. He loved all of us. But these last 10 months have been horrific for us. Because as I mentioned, Alzheimer's took the emotional side of my dad. It didn't take the intelligent side, which I feel was a curse. Because for the last 10 months, this amazing woman in front of me has been Diane. She hasn't been wife. She hasn't been bride. And my dad has desperately tried to find that woman every day. And it killed us to see that happen to my mom. And she was there by his side to the end. Late spring, it was getting really bad. I mean, to the point where from the time he got up till the time he'd go to bed, he needed to find his wife and he needed to get home. And she was a rock. And I know she doesn't see herself as that, but she was a rock through all of that. And her vows are what kept him home for so long. She kept saying to us, I don't want to let him go. Because I said in sickness and in health. And that was the hardest thing for my mom, was letting him go. And yet I know in hindsight, we know we did the best thing for him, moving him to provision living. So for 10 months or maybe more, my mom didn't have that side of my dad. But God is so good. Because over the last couple of months, she has gotten some amazing nuggets out of all of this. My dad has had to go in the hospital a few times over the last few months. I'll tell you, this pandemic has really sucked. Because for 3 months, the most my mom could see, or any of us could see, was my dad 12 feet through a fence. We couldn't touch him. We couldn't hold him. But when he'd go in the hospital, my mom could see him. And she could hold him, and she could hold his hand. In the summer, he was in for something, I don't remember what, and my mom was talking to him about when they met. And again, there was some fuzziness with him. And she says, well, Bill, for those of you who have lived here for years, you might remember that there was a dance hall up on West River Drive, Ramona Terrace. And that's where my mom and dad met, actually. And she says, well, we met there. Do you remember that? And he says, was that you? And she says, yeah, that was me. And he said, I had such a crush on her. And my mom said, he never told her that in all these years of marriage. Because I didn't know he had a crush on me. Obviously, he did. He married you. But my dad just wasn't like that. He just wasn't super affectionate where he would share that. And here we are 50 years into their marriage, and he said, I had such a crush on her. And then about a week before Rachel's wedding, my dad went in again for pneumonia, another bout of pneumonia, and she got to sit with my dad for 2 days. And I know that those are probably two of the most special days that she had with my dad. And she called me from the hospital at one point, and she said, your dad wants to cuddle. Now, my dad was intelligent. He had a great vocabulary, but I will be the first to say I never heard my dad say cuddle, ever. So there must have been cuddling pre-Brett and Carrie back in the day. And I think you did climb up in the bed with him at one point, and he had his arm around you. And I remember calling him. I said, you're not going to believe this, but Dad wants to cuddle with Mom. And there was silence on the end of the phone. But she got to cuddle with my dad, and those 2 days were just remarkable because she had a lot of Bill back, and I think he had a lot of recognition of my mom during that time. And then last week, my mom went in to see him. The good news was we could all go in to see my dad. And the bad news was we could all go in to see my dad. So we knew the end was near. And when she went in to see him, there was one moment where he was lucid, and he took her hand, and he brought it up to his mouth, and he kissed it, and he told her that he loved her. And then a couple days later, he was pretty much non-responsive by that point. We would get an open eye once in a while, and we would get a squeeze once in a while. And she went to leave maybe Monday night, Tuesday night, and she said, "I'll be back tomorrow, Bill. I love you." And he squeezed her hand 3 times. And she stopped, and she leaned over him, and she says, "Is that I love you?" And he did it again, 3 more times. He loved her to the end. The picture on the back of your program, the picture of their hands was taken just a couple hours before my dad passed. And that depicts my mom and dad. In sickness and in health, you were there through it all, Mom. You really were. You never let my dad down. To love and to cherish till death do us part. He was a wonderful, wonderful man. We love you. Thank you, everybody, for being here.
So I was in the same spot that Carrie was. My mom looked at me and she said, "Are you going to say anything?" I said, "Nope." She said, "Are you sure you're not going to say anything?" I said, "Mom, I love you to death, but I can't do it." Then she looked at me, and if you know her, she goes, "Well, you better start practicing for mine." So this is practice. Carrie did such a phenomenal job walking through the attributes of my dad. I can't really add to that. I will say he supported his kids, his grandkids, through all their dreams. And I appreciate that. I appreciate the Christ-centered home that I grew up in, and I appreciate him picking my mom. I just want to share one memory with you. This is probably the most vivid memory I have of my dad. So when I was in college, I played men's league hockey. And so I would come home for the weekends. I would play hockey on Sunday night, and then I'd drive up to Ferris at night. And once in a while, my dad would come. And I still remember it was one night I walked out. I'm like, "Hey, you can come to the game." And he's like, I don't know. So we were playing the game. I was going down the left-hand side in the zone. I had the puck, and I went in hard on the goalie. Someone tripped me. And all I remember very clearly is myself and the puck cleared the line at the same time. And I watched the puck go over the line. And then I looked up from inside the net to get myself out. My dad was standing in the corner, smiling ear to ear. And as I got myself out of the net and, you know, even talking to him, it was just, I'll never forget. He came on a Sunday night, late at night. It was a 30-minute drive, and it was a freezing cold arena. But it's just a great memory. And then to hear him retell the story of how he walked in and happened to come right to the glass, seeing me come down the ice and then go headfirst into the net. He's like, "I didn't really realize you scored." I'm like, "Oh, I saw the puck right there." So that is probably one of my best memories of my dad. And I told him that a few years ago. I'm like, that was so great. And it was the support. It was the wanting to see his kids, wanting to see his grandkids. So.
No, I'll just keep it short. I had a half-hour speech, but I'll just say I think this is the longest Bill's ever been up in front of church.
There's a fearsome foursome here. So, guys, why don't you come on up here, and I'll just give, I think, Chad, you're the youngest here. So we'll start with Nate. Mr. Nate, there you go.
Hear me? Oh, there we go. Okay. Well, I am the oldest grandchild, the favorite grandchild of Bill. I've obviously spent the most time with Bill. When I was little, Bill and Diane, you guys know her as Diane, we know her as DJ, Diane Jean. They used to babysit me when I was little. Both my parents worked, and I have a few memories as, you know, a 6-year-old, 7-year-old. I would sit on the basement stairs at their house, and I would wait for my grandpa. He had a little office downstairs, and I would wait. I could see him working through the crack in the door, and I would sit there on the stairs and wait for him to wave me over to come, and I would sit on his lap, and I would draw, and I would do whatever while he was working. My grandpa had a pretty big role in my career. When I was little, my grandpa used to take me to the airport, and we used to sit there and watch planes together for hours. And as you know, now I'm a pilot, and my grandpa had a big role in that.
For those of you who don't know, I'm Chad Wabinga, his real favorite grandson. I'll show you one thing that I'll never forget of my grandpa is that both me and Nate and my Uncle Brett, we played hockey. I played for 15, 16 years, and my grandpa never missed a home game. He would come to away games as far as Detroit, down to Traverse City, and my grandma actually told me a story a while back about how his parents sent him to learn how to swim. And he said his parents got a call about half hour into it saying there's no hope, he can't swim. So even though he wasn't the best athlete, he still supported me for many, many years, and I'll never forget that.
I'm Jared. I'm the real favorite. As many of you know, my grandpa loved cars, and I have the Grand Prix now to this day, which, according to Pastor Jeff, is every time it rolled in, everyone's necks kind of turned and looked at it. But it's really special because he was such a humble man, and that car really shows that. Because I mean, even kids made fun of me the first day I drove into school with it. They said, "What a grandpa car!" And then I popped the hood, and they all got some respect for me. So it really shows you his character and just the fact that the inside of him was so good, but also the outside, everyone respected.
I'm Drew. I'm the youngest grandchild, so I guess by default that makes me the favorite. I think him and I had a lot in common. We both enjoyed school a lot. He talked to me about that all the time. And we were also very quiet, and in larger groups, like at Christmas, we'd be sitting at the couch, and we'd just be looking around, observing while everyone talked, and he'd just look at me, he'd just smile. So that was nice. He was a really good man. I loved him a lot.
Terrific, just wonderful. I'm also going to offer to the immediate family, is there anyone else that would like to share a brief word? If you are, sometimes the Lord just kind of moves on people's hearts. So anyone else in the immediate family? Okay, thank you very much. What fantastic words from the family. And Carrie and Brett, you guys are just awesome. That's wonderful. Your dad adored you. You know that. Well, we're going to sing now as we leave death and we leave Alzheimer's and some of the trials, and we go to the future, because the future is wonderful for Bill and for all of us. And this song was requested by the family, There Is a Higher Throne, and I'd like to ask that you would all stand with me, and Tom, we're going to sing that together. Our future with the Lord.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to have a couple of important scriptures from the New Testament, and I think that every homegoing funeral service, I think, should always be reminded of the central hope we always have. And I thought Carrie touched on it, talking about Bill's hope was nothing he did, but he had a great, steadfast, everlasting hope that Christ was risen. Bill carried Easter with him all his life, and we celebrate that. And as we take a look at the story that we're celebrating today for Bill, we ultimately have to look to the empty tomb. I'm going to read a passage from Matthew chapter 28. Isn't it a wonderful thing to know that the Lord is risen? Easter is every day. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead people. And the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He has risen just as he said. Come now and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into the Galilee, and there you will see him. Now I've told you." So the women hurried from the tomb, afraid and yet filled with joy. Just imagine that moment. Uncertain, afraid, but yet filled with a joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings." Wow, what a moment. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers, and go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Wow, what an amazing thing just to realize that. I remember hearing that as a college freshman. I thought, what? People coming back from the dead? Unbelievable. It's still as powerful to me now at 65 as it was when I was 19. I'd like to take a look at another passage here, and this is really, I think, a focus on particularly Bill and his family. And I'm going to use a passage from the New Testament in the book of Ephesians. You know, what we need today in our society is we need order, we need love, we need God's purposes and plans. And I would say at the order and at the heart of everything the Lord wants to do, to speak to us, is he wants us to look at the family. The family is the picture of God's love for the world. It's a picture of a husband loving his wife as Christ loved the church. And we've lost a lot of that, and I think a lot of people are hurting today because we've lost our plans, we've lost our order, we've lost God's design. Ephesians chapter 5, and I want to just say this too, that I've been around a long time now here in the church world, and I can look back over my years. I do not remember any couple that reflected Christ in the church any better than Bill and Diane Kooistra. And we desperately, desperately need them and what they reflect. You know, I look at this back picture on the bulletin. When I saw that, I got those pictures, I just about wept. You don't see that sort of thing, and we need it. We need it very much today. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, our Lord speaks to Christian husbands. "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless." Now there it is, the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, the sacrificial love of God for us, reflected through Bill Kooistra, through husbands. And Paul continues, "In the same way husbands ought to love their wives." Boy, if that happened, what would happen to this country, huh? "In the same way husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies, he who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. And for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh." And this is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. "However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. I think the Kooistras have done an absolutely incredible biblical job of that passage. And I think the legacy that all of you have here is out of what happened that Bill and Diane lived out. And I think they spoke to me, and I know that they have spoken to so many of us, that God has a plan, and we got to see a glimpse of it with Bill and Diane, and we see the legacy now that in their beautiful family here today. But one of the things that I like about Diane is she's willing to tell you what she's thinking, and I do that. One of the things she came up to me one time, and she says, you know, we need to close our service a little differently. I said, oh, really? She said, why don't you go talk to Glenn? And the last thing you know, she says, I think we should, instead of saying the Lord's Prayer, I think we should sing it. Let's do that. So the next thing you know, we had that. It really went over big. It was a wonderful thing. And so we're going to do that now. Have you ever sung the Lord's Prayer? It's a beautiful thing. We're going to do that together as a church family. And then I bring a brief message about Bill's amazing and wonderful life. Would you all stand with me as we sing the Lord's Prayer? Be seated. Isn't that powerful? Powerful. Diane, thank you for bringing that in. I don't know why we didn't do that earlier. You know, years ago, shouldn't that 20 years ago around here? Well, I have the privilege of sharing a few words here today about Bill. And, you know, one of the things about Bill, Bill is 24 years older than me. But every time we had lunch or talked or spent discussions about anything, we're always at the same age because it was the Lord, you know. In the Lord, there are no such things as generational differences. In the Lord, we all have the common faith in our wonderful Lord. And I think I've shared with the family through the visitations and really in the last year or two, particularly as Bill was having some health issues, that I'm a little bit of a grieving pastor about Bill's passing. I deeply grieve his loss. I celebrate his homegoing, but part of the reason I'm grieving a little bit on Bill's loss, and I said this to Diane and the family, we are not replacing people in our country with Bill Kooistras. Our churches are not getting new Bill Kooistras. I don't know really what's happening out there today, but I can tell you this, that we are in some trouble down here, and you probably all see it. I don't need to tell you that. But the reason that we're in trouble is a very simple reason. It's very simple, maybe not believed by many people these days. But the reason we're in trouble is we don't have any foundations left. The The Bible says in its 11th Psalm, when the foundations are gone, what do God's people do? You ever wondered that today? I have. When the foundations are gone, what will God's people do? I heard a statistic here recently that shocked me, and you probably heard this. You probably know there's a lot of chaos going on out there, and we've had the pandemic and now the riots and political chaos. It's just a lot of chaos. And they did a poll. This is George Gallup did a poll recently, and he said that of our young people, 18 to 25, 1 in 4 of our young people today have thought about suicide. Have you heard that statistic? 1 in 4. Now, when you're 18 to 25, and I remember when I was 18 to 25, this is a time when you think about cute girls and cars and hopefully the Lord. It should be a time of great optimism about the future, but what is happening today is that important foundations are eroding, and now young people, particularly our young people, and I think the adults as well, we have no idea what to do anymore. And what people have found out the hard way is that without meaning and foundations, life is meaningless. And we have not been designed by the Lord to live a meaningless life. We've been designed to live a life full of meaning, full of purpose, full of love. Bill Kooistra got that from his earliest embrace of the Lord Jesus Christ all the way through his life. In every single conversation I had with Bill, he never wavered. He never changed. You know, what we're hearing today everywhere in our society is we always need new improved. You ever notice that? We always need new and improved. We also are looking for new improved churches. Somehow, the message of the gospel is getting lost amidst the new and improved. But Bill was never led astray by form. Bill knew substance. He knew the really important issues, and he rested on them. He stood on them in the Lord Jesus Christ all his life. And his great prayer for his wife and family and children and all of us is that we would do that too. Matthew chapter 7, our Lord gives this exact story, I believe, of Bill's entire life, and I think it is the greatest message of the hour. I want to say if there's one message that should be preached in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, it is this message from Matthew chapter 7. It is a message about foundations, about having something that we can rest on, something that we can build upon, something that we can trust in, that we know will always be there, something that isn't going to change because of the latest soundbite from the media. Matthew chapter 7, and our Lord says these things. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish person, a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. And listen to how this ends, because it's a fascinating part of what he just said. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers. What was the problem with the teachers of Israel? They all had different opinions. That's what's destroying America, opinions, even in the church. You can't build on an opinion. You can't build on things that are going to change week to week. And I think one of the wonderful, wonderful things about Bill is that he never based his life on any opinion. It was always on the Lord. Always. No thought about it. How did we move away from that great generation to kind of what's happening now. We're all a little bit unsettled, aren't we? Aren't you feeling it out there? We're all a little bit unsettled. And I'll tell you right now, you know, just 1 hour, 1 hour of watching the media today or anything out there today, and you're going to be unsettled. Isn't that the case? I mean, any of us who are watching what's going on out there, and as you watch the media, and we've been watching, how about just the last 5 months? Is that enough for us? That's the last 5 months. Here's what I would say in this culture today. What's next? If we know what the last 5 months has been happening, what has to be next? I don't know, but here's what I know is coming. It's going to be a little crazy. And what our Lord is telling us in Matthew chapter 7 is that we're all in a situation where we have to decide how are we going to live our life. Are we going to live our life based on foundational things? Are we going to put it on a rock? Are we going to put it on Him? Are we going to build on something that's going to last, or are we going to build it on politics? That's not a good one, by the way. Culture? The latest trendy, cool thing to do at church? What are we really going to build our life on? And so the whole story is we've just got to have a foundation. That's what we're all needing. That's what the country needs. I don't care whatever our thoughts, politically or otherwise, we need something that is going to endure and last and be solid and strong that we can build not only for our lives, but for our children and grandchildren. You know, I had the privilege of just becoming a grandparent here in the last few months. And I look at Bill and Diane's beautiful grandchildren. What handsome grandchildren, huh? Have you ever thought about this? What would life be like for my grandsons now? I've got two, one on the way. What's this world going to be like in 15, 20 years without a foundation? See, we all know, and I think, how can we miss it, that the storms are coming. Winds are about to blow. They're already blowing now. And when this stuff really starts to hit, and I think we're just getting started here, once this stuff really starts pounding against our young people, against my grandchildren or anybody else, are we going to be able to stand? And if we don't have a foundation of something that we value, that's eternal, that's wonderful in the Lord, we're going to get hit and something has to happen to us. There's no other way about it. Now, one thing about Bill, he was so solid, he never even thought about these things. He knew whatever happened, if the world ended tomorrow, the Lord's running things, everything will be all right. Bill knew that. There was no question or equivocating. He wasn't sitting around and going, oh, I wonder what's going to happen in 1,000 years. No. Bill's heart was settled on the rock, settled on the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, in 37 years of ministry, there are only a few people, I can probably count them on two hands, that use the word heresy. Bill Kooistra used the word heresy. Something would come up in conversation and Bill would say, well, Jeff, that's a heresy. And he was very clear about it. I guess some people would say dogmatic. And the problem we're having today is, well, that's your opinion. Everybody's got an opinion. Bill, you got an opinion, you know, you got an opinion. Everybody's got an opinion. But when Bill would say heresy, it was based on measuring it against something that was solid, something that was going to stand. It was on the Lord Jesus Christ. It was on Scripture. It was on what was eternal and important in life and for families. And Bill would not allow anything to come against that and attack it. And so anything that would come against those foundations, Bill would lovingly speak in his gentlemanly way and say, you know, Jeff, that's a heresy. I remember the first time he said that. I think one of the first times was over at my house. I think you and Bill were over there. He said heresy, and I thought, I just almost wanted to begin praising God. Somebody actually believes something is wrong down here. We don't have a lot of that. Everything, well, whatever. Just, you know, do your thing. Feel good. If you want to believe that, oh, great, go your way. But that kind of freedom is killing us. It's killing us. And Bill knew that, and I do praise him. I want to just leave you with a thought here. His legacy to us, to me, his pastor and friend, to you, dear Diane, to your beautiful, amazing family. I'm looking here at these beautiful people here in front of me, Carrie and Brett, Mark and Jody, Nathan, Rachel, Chad, Jared, Drew. Listen, my dear friends and family, the greatest thing that we're here to talk about is that Bill gave you what the Lord wanted you to have, himself. His foundation is the basis for everything. And not only all the blessings I believe that you have now, but let's roll ahead a few years when that car eventually rusts, if it does. As we look to the future, as the years go by, what are we going to build our lives on? Bill would tell us, the Lord Jesus Christ would tell us, Scripture tells us, if we build on Him, no matter what happens in our life, we'll be fine. The storms will pass, but we will stand on Him. That's my prayer. I believe that that is Bill's legacy to all of us here today. Because one thing that I know for sure here today at the age of 65, storms are coming. And because of our Lord's love for this world, if we'll just stand with Him and on Him and trust Him, everything will be all right. To God be the glory, great things He's done. Let's pray. Well, our Father, we thank You that there isn't one of us here who doesn't live somewhere in a house, a condominium, an apartment that had a foundation. We thank You for our Lord's wonderful words that just remind us you can't build anything without a foundation. And yet, Father, sometimes, I think we all, I know this has been true in my case, sometimes, Lord, we try to build a life, a relationship, a business, a marriage. We try to build things, and we haven't really looked at the foundation of it. Lord, I think the legacy of Bill is that he knew that without Your foundation, without You being there, nothing else mattered, that everything in the else would fade away. And so we thank You for his life and his testimony and his legacy to his beautiful family, to all of us here today. And Father, as we leave here today, I'm praying, Lord, that we have more Bill Kooistras in our churches, that we have more Bill Kooistras in our culture, in our politics, in everything. And I pray, Lord, that for Bill's family, for all of us, that we hear something today that makes us remember and realize that without a foundation, something in the end will take us down. So may we rest on Your love and grace in the Lord Jesus Christ and the finished work of the cross. And may each of us here today leave here looking for that foundation and finding it by Your amazing grace. May that be so for Your honor and glory and for the advancement of our Lord's kingdom. And we pray this in His wonderful name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to close here with a song, and then we have some wonderful things to conclude our service. We're going to sing, do they get any more classic than this, How Great Thou Art? Would you all please join me as we sing this great and amazing song?
I see the stars, I hear the
Amen. You may be seated. Let me make a comment as a 65-year-old man. They don't write hymns like that anymore, huh? Anyway, one of the things we've been asked, and I think a beautiful way to close this service is a little bit about Bill's early life. I have this picture because I talked to Bill about his parents, and we had some discussions about his folks, and he grew up just a nice Dutch kid in church. Remember when the city used to be like that? I can see him, you know, in those young years, probably a little nervous about the domine, the pastor, I don't know. I hope not, but probably like most kids back then. But people actually memorized things that were important about the Lord. I don't think we do as much of that anymore. We're going to close the service with the Heidelberg Catechism. So let's put that out. You know, if we could remember this one question and answer, we'd have everything we ever needed. You know that? Because here's the question. I'm going to lead the question. Can all share together the answer. This is something Bill knew by heart. Some of you may know that. I don't know that even people know any of these things anymore. But here's the thing. If we don't know these things, what do we know? And sometimes we replace something with nothing. Here's the great question. What is our only comfort in life and death? Would you join me? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to Him, Christ, by His Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for Him. Amen. Well, we're going to have a recession. Let me explain. We're thankful. We said our weather prayer, so it looks like we're going to be able to be outside. And so here's what we're going to be doing. We're going to have Bill's casket escorted out of the sanctuary with amazing grace. Wow, what a great thing. So that's going to come up here in a second. And as we escort Bill's casket with the pallbearers following out the door, we're asking you all to join us and to come out and join us out by the hearse right out here in the front of the church. And we're going to have a military salute from the Kent County Veterans Department with guns. Blanks, but with guns. It's a very powerful thing, and one of the things that I think was very important to Bill was a love for this country and for respect for his military service and what it meant to him and to all of us. So we're going to go ahead, and I guess we're going to have the funeral directors are going to come forward here. We're going to begin to get this processional put together. And as we do that again, we hope that you will not only join us outside, but that you will also stay with us for lunch.